So hello everyone, I'm Michał Szepielak and I'm working in Samsung Electronics in Poland and in the center of R&D as a software engineer, and I'm a part of the team that is responsible for developing Tizen Web UI framework. So I'm glad that you are here and I can share with you my knowledge about the fluid design. And I assume that you have some basic knowledge about HTML and CSS. So today we'll talk about developing web application for variety devices such as TVs, mobiles, and wearables. And I will try to convince you that the one app can rule them all, of course. Thank you for coming once again, and I hope you enjoy my speech. Before we start, let me show you an agenda. First, we will talk about the responsive approach. I'll talk about what is it and how to use it, and I would like to explain the advantages and challenges. Second part will be more technical part, and we'll talk about how to create it and talk about something about viewports and media queries, because you need to use this. There are also a few strategies that you need to use, and you can use during the development, and I would like to introduce you three of them. After that, I show you some tips and tricks that you can optimize your web application, especially in handling the images. After that, we'll talk about slightly about the responsive coding. Tizen provides you to the common API, and you can use this, the same code through the different profiles, so we have to use it, and we should use it. And the last part will be about tools and frameworks that will speed up your development, and that's all for today. So first of all, I would like to introduce you Mark. Mark is actually a web app developer, and he's happy. He's a big smile because he already developed his first web application on the Tizen store. And this was a simple web application. It's only showing the current weather for selected city. But this was a very great app. And the Mark's app was successful against the larger audience and larger audience. So thanks to the reviewing system on the Tizen store and the comments, he starts to giving a feedback from users. So one of them would like to have this app on the mobile smartphones, and one of them on the tablets, and the other ones would like to have a big weather conditions of the TVs. So it was really motivating for Mark. He felt the power of doing this. So he would like to cover all needs of his audience. And he needs to make a short analysis of the resolutions that he needs to cover. He started for the little guy from the wearable devices. So there are two kinds of resolution for the gear. The second, there are 320 and 320. And for the gear S, it's 360 on 480. And getting the biggest device like TVs, there are two resolutions. It's high definition and high definition ready. And going down with the screen size, he picked the tablets. There are actually the two common resolutions for Galaxy Tab is 224 and on 60, and 1280 on 800 for Galaxy Tab 7.7 inch. And Samsung has variety smartphones, so there is the biggest family of this, and he picks only that one smartphone that to avoid duplicates of the resolution. So he started from the Galaxy S the second, from the resolution in 800 on 480, and for his younger brother it's 1280 on 720, and the Galaxy Gravity Samsung Gravity Smart is 320 and 480. Actually, it's 9 different resolutions, and it makes 13 variants of user interface, including landscape and portrait mode. It's really huge work. But don't worry, Mark is a pro. He would like to cover all of these sizes, and he will probably spend a few weeks on adapting his app for these 13 variants. It's okay, it can be done once, but someday some of his audience, some of his end user will call, hey, I would like, for example, have a new feature. So for now, he need to modify 9 apps. It's really a lot of work. Of course, in dealing with different devices, the resolution is not only the issue. We have different device types. for example, you use slightly different the tablet and the smartphone. Probably tablet you use using two hands, and the smartphone you probably use one hand. There are small differences. There are differences, of course, with your control. If you have mobile devices which are touchable. If you would like to create an app for the TV, there is only a remote control. The pixel density is also the issue, because devices have different pixel density, so you need different graphic materials for providing for these devices. And you also, besides the behavior differences, there are also the hardware and software differences. Have you ever thought that why the TV 15-inch that has the same resolution like the 5-inch smartphone is quite different? So you also need the you different use the smartwatch, because the distance between the user and the device is different. For example, if you use your gear, you have it on your hand, it's the distance between the eyes and the device is about 40 centimeters. And when you use your TV, the distance between you and the TV is about 3 meters. So you need to consider this, because actually the screen is bigger, but if the distance is wider, it comes to be slower in your eyes, so you need to add more bigger margins, bigger layout, and so on. Okay, we have passed through the quick introduction, and I would like to start about the responsive approach. And the term responsiveness could be familiar for those people who create modern websites. And creating classic websites was actually a fixed size, and it was very easy. But when screen starts have to vary resolutions, the user experience for browsing that website was going to worse, because on the huge screens you had only the thin stripe of the website. It was looking very bad. And Tizen gives you opportunity to create your web application in a responsive way by using the power of the web technologies. You can fully use relative measurement for creating the websites and media queries for supporting the breakpoints of the layout. And with a pinch of the JavaScript and the common device API, which is accessible from JavaScript, it makes really true cross-platform way of building to web applications. In a perfect world, it would be that you have one app package and you can install it on every device, and you will receive the same user experience and look and feel without any other configuration. This may be very unrealistic, but thanks to Tizen, it's quite possible. So, building responsive applications targeted for Tizen platform, and you can use, thanks to the web engine and the standards, web standards, which are actually hold across all Samsung products. It's great, though, to have your application which looks great on different devices and is still functional. Maybe do you still remember Mark? Mark was dealing with the weather app, which for different resolutions. And the main purpose of the weather app is actually showing the weather. And this weather concept will show the weather for the selected city and the average temperature for day and night for the next week. And so this is a concept for doing this. So since the gear screen size is very small, you can prioritize your content. You have to find the main content with the which is the best in the context. So the main purpose is to show the weather for the selected city, but to show the other part of the web application, you can hide it and make it accessible with more buttons. So this is one of the technique. Actually, this application is only impossible to do from one reason. The weather condition in Warsaw in November is not so good. It's only that thing, but for those that are not familiar with world map, the Poland is in the middle Europe. So for now, they have about six Celsius degrees, so it's very cold. And let's leave behind the weather conditions. The other requirements are feasible, so let's go further. Following responsive design, it really pays off, because the biggest advantage of doing responsive application is that developers always maintain the same core. And the having responsive application is actually something like an insurance for the future, because if there are bigger or smaller devices, screens, your application will automatically adapt to the new product. So, for example, there were when the Gear S starts to become the market, automatically the apps which was created on the Gear the second was checked automatically if they will be compatible with the Gear S. And most of apps, there are a few differences between Gear S and Gear the second. For example, the Gear S don't have camera, so every app which was using the camera were obviously rejected. But many of apps which was built on the Gear the second has fixed size, was fixed size like here. So running on the Gear S, there was a lot of unusable space, but adding only a few additional lines to HTML markup, it would be fit. It would be capable for the Gear S. So it really pays off. Responsive design, of course, comes with some challenges. Using swipe, for example, on the Gear is quite very intuitive, but it can be used on TVs because there are not touched events. If you create application for various devices, you need to take into account that they have various hardware inside, so you need to optimize your application because the various devices with various hardware have various, of course, the memory limit usage, and the performance of this device is also different. So please keep your application optimized, because it's and free of the bad code. And the last challenge that I listed is here is adjusting layout breakpoints. layer breakpoints are just sets of conditions that that your layout change your structure. It can be used mostly by it can be done mostly by CSS media queries, but sometimes you need to use JavaScript, unfortunately. Okay, we have some basics about the basic information about the repositories responsive. Let's pop to the more technical part. And this is a little bit history for this. CSS, the media types in CSS 2.1 was like a seed for responsive designs because you could create a different layout. For example, for printed documents, you could hide unnecessary navigation bars or advertisement and so on. And when the screen starts to be larger and the screens will start to be larger, the fixed size, as I said before, fixed size website starts to be looks worse. And when the mobile revolution starts, which was really great, the end users have really different device resolutions. So developers need to have challenge to match all of this. And finally, the CSS3 and HTML5 provides the media queries when you can and relative measurement and viewport that you can adapt your layout for the different screen sizes. If you think in a responsive way, you should forget about the window screen. There is only a viewport, but what is a viewport? Actually, viewport determines the visible area of your web application. It has own measurement. So you can set your viewport dimensions. It's really great. Viewport has few configurations that you can set the dimension, like the width and height. You can also set the initial scale for this, and the minimum and maximum initial scale. And you can disable, you can prevent zooming, for example, your web application. But you should be careful with this because some of the people has worse sight than you, so they would like to zoom to for better reading. And this is how the viewport works actually. Setting viewport is very easy because you put just the meta tag inside the head section. You call the meta type with the attribute name viewport, and in the attribute content, you provide the settings for it. In this example, there is a viewport set to device width, which I recommend doing this. Of course, you can set the fixed size, but we talk about the fixed size viewport later during the strategies. Okay, so let's go on. There is also a question, how many pixels contains one pixel? If you take the text specs of the Galaxy S4, actually you see that the Galaxy S4 has a full high definition resolution. But if you call it from the JavaScript, you receive this only 300 pixels on 400 pixels in portrait mode. So does it mean that Samsung cheated us? Of course not, because there, Samsung provides you the resolution which for the from the screen. There are two kinds of pixels actually. There are logical pixels like here, because the screen is built with small dots. They are physical pixels, so that these are physical pixels, but there are also a software pixel. Software pixel is made from few pixels, few physical pixels. So the factor which determines how many pixels contains one pixel, we call it the pixel device ratio, which is actually the device property. Okay, let's start with an example. For example, you created a sidebar on the mobile for 200 pixels, and you'd like to have the sidebar on the gear, and actually the 2 pixels takes almost more than half of the gear. So you should use relative units. For example, you can set for example 50. You'd like to have a sidebar which contain the half of the screen. You can use your viewport units. Like here, these units like are the viewport width and viewport height units. It's actually a percentage of the viewport dimension. We have also amps units, which are good for fonts, and root amps, which are slightly similar to amps, but amps based on the parent's font size, and the root amps always based from the root font size, which was set on body on the HTML tag. The percentage is a little bit similar to viewport width and height, but the percentage also based on the parent's container size. So using relative units, it will always adapt to different size of the containers on the viewport size and so on. Here's an example. So if you use this div, for example, we set the div that is always a half of width of the viewport. It doesn't depend that you have it on a or mobile on the gear on the TV. It's always be the half of the screen, and this font size is always twice bigger than it was set by the manufacturer. If you have a paragraph inside this div, you can use the font size which depends on the parent's font size. It's good for keeping the aspect ratio between the, for example, you always need header which is bigger twice than the container. You should use AMs, but if you would like to have always font which is twice bigger than your root font, you should use RAMs. Media queries are the best of all to accomplish the responsive layouts. They give the developer an easy way for defining the breakpoints. You can create a set of conditions on the device time, for example, the TVs, handheld, print, screen, whatever. You can also check the device aspect ratios, device dimensions, color depth, and there are plenty of options for creating the rules. So using breakpoints in your layout, actually you define how your layout will behave in different conditions. Here is an example. First, here is set the left column is hidden normally, and he's displayed the more button. As you can see in the smartphone, there is no left column, it's only the more button here. But if media queries match with the width of the viewport will be greater than 400 pixels, like here, which is matching, the left column will be show up and the more button will be disappear. This is how the media queries is working. And here is an extension. If we normally define the right column and left column, which is not displayed on the device, and you match the device with, for example, 1,000 pixels, which keeps here, the left column will appear. But here is the same condition, but there is a device type. And here we have TV, so these media queries will match and display additional right column. Okay, so we have some technical part behind us, and let's go through the strategies. We have three of them. First, it's a viewport scaling. So you can set your viewport for the fixed width, and from the developer way, from the developer points of view, it's always be 320 width, even if the screen will be full high definition. It is actually the easiest way to make a web application, when your layout is scaled. But you need to be careful with the bitmaps, because scaling bitmaps, the quality of the bitmaps will be worse, so it will be pixelated. This is the tricky part. What will be if you fix the viewport from the same dimensions, like the square, like on the gear S, and you'd like to run it on the gear, like in here in the gear the second, and you would like to run it on the gear S, it will be distorted. The layout will be adapt. The layout will be think that this is square, but it isn't, and it will be show. It will be distorted, unfortunately. So I recommend you to set only the one of the dimension, for example, width or height, whatever you like, but the both is a little bit danger. The second most, some of them maybe heard about the mobile first, but if we have Tizen, it's rather the wearable first. So you need to take care about the little one, the gear, because often smaller devices are weaker. So your layout enhance with the resolution when it started to be bigger. And also you need to know well the context of the web application to set to prioritize your content. For wedge faces, it probably the showing the time, and the other options can be hidden by and they will be accessible by, for example, more button. The second way is to make it fluid. Fluid designs are made from fluid boxes. Here is an example. I think it will be the best. This is the same design shown on different resolutions, different devices. As you can see, this block and this block, they are fluid, and they will adapt. They have different size, and also this, it will be scaled and it will adapt for the different size of the device. So you should hide elements when they are actually not necessary. Using, for example, the more button, and use it like here in an example. There are also some tips and tricks which will be handy during the responsive development. Handling images are actually an issue. It's good to use images that are vector-based, because the bitmaps are sometimes problematic. If you use too small bitmap on the bigger device, it will be pixelated. So you can avoid this thing using media queries, for example, and check if the device width is higher and is greater, you can swap the background image. It can be doable. For icons, the best are actually vector-based images like SVG, and you can use also the font icons. It's okay. If you'd like to deal with block elements to keep the aspect ratio, you can, for images, it's actually easy because you can set only the one dimension to, for example, 100%, and the other one for the auto, and the browser will adapt, will keep the aspect ratio of the image. You can also, for the block elements, for the icons, it's very handy. You can set the background size as a contain. It means that it will contain in the container, so the aspect ratio of this block wouldn't be different. And this one is the tricky part. Actually, it's designed for the block elements. And believe me, it works. And if you'd like to learn about this, you can contact with me, and I will send you code snippets, and maybe you can play with this. There is responsive coding, of course. When you deal with your UI, you should write your code in a responsive way. Thanks to Tizen, we have standards and we love this. You can have access for different APIs. It's actually W3C standards. So accelerometer and gyroscopes are available through JavaScript in the same profile. So for example, if you is the same code running on the gear, and the same content, and the same code will run on the mobile, so it's cross-platform. But you need to be aware that you have to check capabilities. For example, Gear the second doesn't support SVG images, and the connectivity is only using SAP, Samsung Accessory Protocol. Gear S doesn't have camera, and you also support HDMI, and TVs are actually navigated by remote control, but they don't have touches. There is a DAO framework which I'm developing with my team. It's quite responsive and works on the device through different profiles. Its name is TAU. TAU is a collection of the UI controls called widgets, which can simplify your application coding. TAU is actually the standalone UI library, so you don't need jQuery for using this. And we do care about the performance of this framework, so you can be sure that it's working fast. The common framework API and widgets, and for wearable and mobile devices in this framework, makes your application universal and you can deploy it faster. However, there are some differences that you should notice, but due device physical limits and the way how they are used, some widgets looks different a little bit. To speed up your development, you can use some tools. It makes it easier for you for this. For debugging, you can use Chrome, because the web applications that you can run on Tizen are WebKit-based. So the Chrome is, with the WebKit engine, it has the developer tools. So you can emulate the touches, you can emulate the viewport settings, you can run your JavaScript code, and you set the debug breakpoints. It's really good and really handy. The disadvantages of this, it doesn't support Tizen object. So you can check your device API how it works. The second tool is a Tizen web simulator, which is available in Tizen SDK. It does support the Tizen object, so you can play with the different sensors. For example, with the geolocation, or you can also use send notifications for your device, or simulate the days calling, the battery is going down, and so on. The Tizen Web Simulator runs on the Google Chrome, so you have also the developer tools. That was so showed before. The third one is a device viewer. Actually, I was working on this. It's a lightweight tool. You can set up max to five badges, and you can check your layout in the fast way. You can dynamically, using the sliders, you can change the size of the layouts, and there are a few presets. Your zoom can be, your workspace can be zoomed to show the even the TV device, for example. The coolest thing in this is it has the separate history for each badge. So you can browse your web application in every badge separately, and you can check the different pages. It doesn't cause the different badges. It also runs on Google Chrome, so you still have the developer tools for emulating viewport, from JavaScript debugging, and so on. And unfortunately, it doesn't support Tizen object yet. And the last one tool is a remote test lab. This service enables developer to access the Samsung mobile devices through the web, and you can install your application on the real device. And this is not only the most effective and easiest way to test the compatibility with any application that you build for any devices, but it's the best way to cut down costs for the hardware or test devices, because you don't have to buy it. And the interaction with the device is performed over the network in the real time, so you just reserve the time, for example, for GRS on 30 minutes, and you can install, debug, and check the your application before distributing it. And that's all. Thank you. If you have any questions, please ask. There are no about the responsive web design or responsive web applications. Okay, so thank you.